Let me get these guys and we'll start. Hey, Yanni, can you grab these guys? Hey, good morning. I will start that again. Good morning.
Good morning.
Nice and hot outside, right?
Yes.
So, yeah, a little more light. Thank you. Hey, we're glad you're here this morning. I just wanted to start off this morning. I was having this conversation with an individual a couple of weeks ago, and they said, could you imagine if you follow your heart with everything you do? And they said, if we followed our heart with everything we do, we would get in so much trouble because we would follow our heart. And so many times in our world, we say, follow your heart. But Jesus says your heart's deception.
Yep.
Right? So just to kind of start the tone this morning, it's not so much about following your heart. Yeah, I followed my heart. I wanted a chocolate milkshake, not vanilla. But I follow the Lord. And that's one of the things we're going to talk about today, is getting in tune, coming in the reality that we fail sometimes. But a Christian means a living faith that follows the Lord. So just want to kind of throw that in your brain this morning, and I'm going to open up in prayer. We got a lot of little things to do today. And in fact, I'm going to do one after I pray. Jesus, thank you for this morning. We thank you for those who've been traveling and are here with us this morning. I pray, I know Pooja is on the road coming back somewhere from Virginia, and many others that are not here with us this morning. We are grateful that you are the living God and that we can come together and we get to hear not so much what someone says, but what your word says. And we are thankful for that. We ask this in Jesus' name, amen. I wanted to, this morning, before we have Leanne come up and lead us in singing, I talked to Howie, and you know, Gadisa passed away over a week ago now. And I was talking to her, and I wanted to read to you, I'm going to read to you what you sent me. They had the funeral in Ethiopia. Her body was sent to Ethiopia. And the ceremony was held in a church that she built 25 years ago. And they told many people about Christ, and many people became followers of Jesus. The church she built used to throw stones at it, and then they stopped when they became believers. Now this church has six branches. I'm Americanizing this, satellite churches. And she said in her final days, her prayers for 8 years, was that Holly would get baptized. And she finally saw that happen at Mayhill. And she brought her grandkids right here. Wave your hands. Come on. Everyone love your grandmother to church so they would know Jesus. And Howie says, actually, she is the one who brought me to Layhill. She got buried in her birthplace, and I think it's pronounced Ambo, Ethiopia. And more than 1,500 people attended the service with 500 horse riders. That's part of the culture they do during a funeral service. So it is sad that she's not here with us, but we know where she's at. She's with Christ, and she played a really cool role in our church. And I want to read something to you, and I want to give this to Holly. I've been holding on to this in my office for a long time. This is the actual letter Gadisa brought when she brought her grandkids to church. It's dated, it's my handwriting here, July 3rd, 2022. I'm going to read to you what she wrote. She remembers, she didn't speak English, just like I don't speak Ethiopian. I am Mrs. I live across the street with my grandchildren. I am the grandmother of these children. I want them to live in godly words. I don't speak English. Anything you guys want to talk to me, you can talk to Harana, can translate. That is pretty cool, isn't it? Yeah. Amen? So, Leanne, let's sing. And I want to give this to Holly, this original copy, to hold on to for all the days of your life. There you go.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. I had some information written down right in my notebook here, and I forgot. So, you ever forget something?
No.
So I wrote it down when I was talking to Pete just a second ago. It's Sonia's birthday. And rumor has it she's like 42.
Yes.
And so I think she's going to go to Amsterdam soon, and then she's not going to be here for a while. So we need to sing happy birthday to her, right?
You guys will sing what is right.
Yes.
Yeah. I'll hit by itself. I promise you.
You are singing also for me. I was born in July.
What's your name, brother?
What's your name?
What's your name, brother?
Alexander.
Alexander.
Happy birthday. Are you
going to
come up?
Happy birthday.
Yeah,
Alexander.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I am just 76 years young.
All right, we got two birthdays in the house of Leo, and we're gonna try to make them as joyful and make them have the best day, birthday of their life. After they leave this door, because I don't know if my voice is going to do that. On three, everybody. One, two, a three.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Sonia Elders. Happy birthday.
So many people that don't have that. They're drinking water that is not clean, it's not healthy. And I want to just, this is a little video, and I can't remember how many years ago it was that we started our water well project. We ran this back then, but it's good every once in a while just to look at why the need is there. So let's just go ahead and take a look at this. It's only about 90 seconds.
All day I faced a barren waste without the taste of water. Throats were dry and songs that cried.
seventh well that we've sponsored. Each well costs about $5,000 to implement. But when it's done, the communities that they put the wells in are giving Christian literature, and they're told that the well is being provided by Christians who are doing this out of love for them. And it's really a wonderful thing. So this well that we're working on now, we're about $1,300 away from being able to get the $5,000 to put another well in. And you know, I would really like to accomplish this before Pastor Rich leaves.
Yeah.
I think that would be great. So I'm just going to ask that in this month of July, that you all might consider just, you know, giving a little extra donation to the water well project, so we can send them off knowing we did another well. And all of you that are watching this out there in YouTube land, you can contribute too. So let's get it done.
You know, one of the things too that I'm reminded of, a lot of places where they put wells in certain areas of the world, one of the reasons they build wells in a community is because so women in their culture don't have to go to the rivers to get the water, because many women are attacked sexually on the way to and back. So there's some, as John said, there's tons of reasons. You know, we take it for granted, like, I don't know, just pick this up. You think it's dark. But, yeah. So, we have a number of items I want to pray for this morning. And, again, we want to pray for those we know aren't here today, they're traveling. And, so let's just, I'm going to ask you how to do this a lot. But just to, like, this morning, take a time and just talk to the Lord what's on your heart. Praise Him for something you just are so thankful for. Maybe you're reminded of your salvation. Just speak to the Lord for a few moments here this morning with the body of Christ. Lord, you have heard our cries this morning. Maybe we are waiting patiently. You've heard our happiness. We've heard how the body of Christ today makes a difference through water wells. We heard this morning that Gadisa is healthy and running the streets with Jesus. We thank you for that. Your love for us, that while we were yet still sinners, you came and you died for us. You took the cost of sin. Lord, we're grateful for that, that every one of us who knows Jesus through repentance, which is an act of love on God's part towards us, we're going to be with Jesus someday. And Father, this morning, reminded of, many of you may not remember this man, but he had a relationship as well, knowing Pete Lee, but Paul Benjamin passed away this past week. We lift him up. I think some of you know Paul. He attended here a lot more years ago. We lift up Don Picone in healing. Maria was here last week. We lift her up, and Ruth's sister, Esther. We continue to pray for Nina. We continue to pray for Michelle, Jen Long's sister. For David Johnson, a police officer who injured his foot on the job, we lift him up. For those with cancer, Gloria Mader, Heather Johnson, Shannon Wiggins, and we all could name someone, maybe not even with cancer, but with a debilitating disease where life is very difficult for them. Lord, we lift up this church And Lord, we know, I've known many people over the years that come in here, and one of the things, the two things they say, and this is because of you in our life, they say, that church is worshipful, and someone said hi to me. And Lord, may we continue to be about who you are. May we continue to be about Jesus Christ. May we continue not to water down Jesus Christ, but continue to hold on to the foundations of who Jesus Christ is and what he said. And Lord, we come to you this morning as we have been looking at the book of James. The book of James isn't over, but it's over here today, but it's not over. But that our life is reflection after you. It's a living faith. It's an obedient faith. It's a faith where we will struggle, but by the power of the Holy Spirit, we have the ability to get it back up. It's a faith that where when we sin, that we don't run from you, but we can run towards you. And Lord, we thank you that it was written. We thank you that your word, even though it was written beyond 20 and 30 and 40 and 50 and 100 years, it's still God's word. It doesn't flow with culture. It flows with who God is and God's standard. Lord, help us with that. Help us see people who need you. Help us see with eyes of compassion. Lord, we thank you that we can gather here today. We thank you again for that reminder of the importance of Christians living out their faith with the simplicity of a couple of coins in a basket that will change a village of water, something that we may take for granted. So Lord, we thank you today. We thank you for this church. We thank you that you're God. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Alrighty. Okay, I always forget. Does someone have the clicker?
I do.
Oh, you do? Okay.
I'm walking.
She's like the caddy of the revival. We want to pray for the kids. All righty. We want to pray for the children as they go down.
Heavenly Father, we look forward to this opportunity to be able to worship you, Lord Jesus, and to study your word downstairs. We thank you for the teachers. We thank you for the students. We ask your blessings upon them.
Thanks, Mary. Alrighty. So I'm going to read to you the last two verses of James, and then we're done, James. But I would encourage you to read it, you know, more. Keep going back to it. One of the things I think about the book of James is the words that I use. I wrestle with things that are said in the scripture, and I try to reflect on it and look at myself. I think that's something that's important in James 5, 19 and 20. And you'll hear it later on today, is that we really reflect on ourselves first. And I think that's very, very important. Let me read these words. This is the very end, chapter 5, 19 to 20. And I want you to be vocal today, okay? Can we be vocal? David, can you help them be Sierra Leone-ish in church today? Okay, all right? It says this, ready? All through the book of James, you ready? My brothers and sisters. Now, who's he talking to?
Believers.
He's talking to believers. Even in these last two verses, he's talking to believers. Amen. You can't strip it out and say that's not true. He's talking to believers. All through the book of James, he's talking to believers. I want him to talk to other people and get the church off the hook, but he's honest enough and loving enough to say, no, I'm talking to believers. So we got that down, right? Talking to Christians. So, my brothers and sisters, if one of you should wander from the truth and someone should bring that person back, remember this. Whoever turns a sinner from the error of their way will save them from death and cover over a multitude of sins. Woo! There's a lot packed up in that two verses. So here's the thing. We're going to be talking today, and if I could use the title, the big idea, is it's stating here. Move your theologies out of your head for a second with all that Calvinism and Arminian stuff, okay? I got a solid C in all of it, okay? Is believers stray, restore the wanderer. We got to be careful so we don't become church police. Okay, there's a balance in there and all that. I knew a guy in college and his nickname was Holy Joe. That was not a compliment. At all. So I'm glad you're here today, and as I said, I've gotten a few texts. People are traveling and all that stuff, and it's hot, isn't it? It's hot outside. I just threw that in there. And I like heat, but it's hot outside. And it's just amazing how fast the summer goes. It's July 7th, and it's going fast. And the reality is we're here to worship God. And I've been saying this a lot lately. We're here not to hear what Rich says or whoever is up front really says, but we're here to hear what God says. Amen? It's about God, right? We want to hear what God says, and each person's personality will come out in how they present that, but really, we're here to hear what God says, okay? And if someone's saying something that's so contradictory, I would give you permission to walk, okay? Because I've seen enough churches where people are saying some crazy stuff out there, okay? And it's nowhere to be found. It's what they wanted to say. But I want to talk to you real quick, though. That song Leanne sang this morning by C.C. Winans, that's who I know it by. That song makes me cry. You ever cry during a song?
Yes.
Oh, good, I thought it was on one. I've listened to that song 20 times this week. And it's not so much that I'm crying, like, the Phillies lost. But it's tears of joy. That, let's make it personal here in Leo. Gedisa is in the presence of God.
Amen.
You're going to die someday. I don't want to blow it on you. I'm not telling you anything you don't know. And you're going to be with Jesus. Tears of joy. Someone may have walked away from Jesus for 40 years. You pray for 41. And you know what I'm talking about. That's tears of joy. I've gotten phone calls in the last month or so. I would cry at my desk. It wasn't I was sad. It was tears of joy. We experience those things, and God is in the midst of that. God is the presence. God is the presence in the good and the bad and the ugly and the extremes, but God is always present. He walks with me and he talks with me.
Yes.
There's tears of joy in that when you know Christ walks with you. Not a magic trick, but the living God who lives and resides inside of you. Listen to the words this morning. And I think it's important to talk about the holiness of God because we are to look towards the holiness of God, right? And God separates us to live after Christ. He gives us the Holy Spirit in order to have the ability to live after Christ. Listen to these words, though. And I would say, and creation cries. And then we go, holy. I think that sounds pretty good. And it sings it over and over again that God, the living God, is holy. He is true today and forever and ever. And one day we're going to be in the heavens because of Christ's forgiveness. And we may just sing that song, the redeemed cry, holy, holy, holy. God's holy. There's something about God's holiness, which I believe is spelled out in other words. There's something about God's truth because God is truth. God is truth. He's holy. And our confession of sin before the living God and our repentance of our sins, it is God's perfection, not our perfection. It is God's perfection who takes the place which makes him holy. Because if Jesus wasn't the God-man, sinless, we're not forgiven. It is holiness that pays the price. The holiness of the living God. And the gospel is priceless. Amen? It's priceless. And it is in that salvation experience where the Lord's Holy Spirit, the same Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead, is in us. That's what the Bible says. To open our eyes to the truth. Think about when you came to Christ, right? Did God open your eyes to things? You're like, oh man, I guess I should be doing that. Anybody? You're like, holy cow, Holy Spirit, open your eyes. Open your eyes to things of God. It's actually you're beginning to tune into God and do life. And that's what the book of James is. It's a book of if you believe in Christ, then there's some living aspects that should be demonstrated. Amidst the falls, amidst the sins, amidst the falling down and getting back up. It's an authenticity of Christ. a living faith, a faith that is lived out according to his word, not the culture. It's God's standard. James says, ready? James is the half-brother of Jesus, and who's he preaching to?
Believers.
Believers that are getting their butts kicked. Thank you. They're getting persecuted. Jesus, I gave my life, but are you really there? Right? That was going on. Disappointment with God is probably the biggest reason people drift. That's my opinion. They begin to drift because they're so disappointed in God. God doesn't say God can handle your disappointment. He can. But a lot of times the disappointment, it comes in little waves and then you start moving. James says to these people, faith without works is dead. Faith that is not lived out, he's saying, is dead. Faith that is not lived out is dead. Or if it's not cared to believe it lived out or disregarded, I'm like, what are you doing? Right? Like, what are you doing? I had a conversation with someone recently and they said, boy, that heart thing. And they said, boy, if we follow our heart, man, we get in a lot of trouble, won't we? Right? Yeah. I mean, if I follow my heart, you wouldn't even allow me to walk in this place, right? but like, And it comes down to this, and this person said to me, but we have to deny ourselves to be holy.
Take up your cross.
To be holy. To be live it out. To care what God says. Not to live it casually. You know, when it's convenient, but an authenticity of Christianity does not mean I just sin when I want to sin and I get my wallet out and I say, well, here's my grace badge. I can do whatever I want, when I want, and it doesn't matter. Well, it doesn't say that in the scriptures. It doesn't say that. And let me say, it's by grace alone that you're saved, by faith alone in Jesus Christ. It's not works. It's God's grace. It's God's forgiveness. It's God's mercy. It's the Romans 5:8 kind of stuff. Why you didn't care about Christ, he still went to the cross for you.
Yes, he did.
Good. Thank you, Jesus.
It doesn't mean that Paul's Romans 7, which I read a lot, the things I don't want to do, I do, and the things I don't want to do, you know what I'm talking about. Let me do that again. The things I don't want to do, I do, and the things I do want to do, I don't do. Paul is struggling. Don't you want the writers to struggle as in they are human beings?
Absolutely.
Who are saved.
Yes.
Who have the Spirit of God, to the ability we talked about weeks ago to get back up and follow Jesus by the power of the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
And there has to become this point. And God's the judge of it all, right? I mean, and we'll get into that, is where the follower of Christ is like, I want to live after Christ. I want to reflect Christ in all I say and do, even when no one is watching. To reflect Christ. Listen to some of the themes in the New Testament and the Old, but I'm going to stick to the New a little bit, maybe so. Stay the course. Don't give up. Run the race. Wait patiently. That's a fun one. How do you cope in life? You better have some joy. Happiness could be overrated. Endure to the end. And if I was writing that, I wanted to make Jesus look really good, I would include those things. But God in his word is honest. God knows how life can be difficult. God knows this raging flesh is fights us. I've used this illustration, I promise, the last time ever. Every centimeter of ice playing hockey is contested. Every part of your life will be contested. Will you choose God or not? I think sometimes we all have these little mini crises of faith. You ever have one? Come on.
Yes.
Right? I'm not saying you leave the faith. You have a little crisis, whatever that may mean to you. A crisis of faith, as our very own disappointment with God. When I was a kid, I told you, and I hurt my hip, and I sat in the doctor's office, Dr. Henry Weider. He was an expert on what I had in Philadelphia, and I would pray, please let me play hockey and football, and he'd look at me and go, no! Well, he said it nicely. I walked away disappointed. Disappointed with God. Hey, I gave you my life. I'm following you. Why? Disappointed. But we see with Christ that we can have peace. We see change in our lives, right? I want you to think of something real quick. How God did, God's power changed you, and you're like, I can't believe I used to do that. Right?
Yeah.
The danger is, on the other end, is when we get disappointed with God sometimes, we start going back to the very same things that God saved us from that led us to the cross. And that's all through the scriptures as well. And I want to get to the, you know, he's saying restore the believer, but we got a long way to go still. The Commanders aren't on this weekend, so we got a lot of time. Okay. We can either run towards him or we can begin to drift from him. And I think there needs to be safe places in the church where people can be allowed to drift without appeasing it. I mean, that's a whole other sermon. I've mentioned the prodigal son a lot lately. We're all prodigals, aren't we? Right? We're prodigals even in our Christian walk sometimes. You know, you might not be eating with pigs, but you took a time out from God for about at least 3 minutes. We're prodigals. The history of Israel, we're prodigals. Yay, Jesus, he's our man. If no one can do it, he can't, you know, they want him. And then they're like, huh, where is he? I don't like what's going on. And then they got to their idols and they did their own thing. Yeah, this is great. And then it led them to, you know, like desperation. Oh yeah, I guess I should go back to the Lord. That's our history. That's one of the very rare moments, right?
Yes.
Can you imagine truly being under persecution? I'm not talking people don't agree with us. I mean, yeah, I'm just, can you imagine literally not sure if you're going to make it through the day?
Yeah.
Will you believe in Jesus? Cell four, put them in there, on the run. I think this is what's going on with James. The persecution, right? And these people are thinking this. Hey, God, I gave you my life. I thought you had a wonderful plan for my life. Right? Forgiveness, I'm following you. And I don't know, the script book's different than I thought it would be. They're under persecution. And I still hold on to a piece of Jesus, but I'm not so sure of the package deal with Christ. Because my mom is running for her life, my uncle's running for his life, we had a Bible study, and they don't like it, and they knock the doors down. You know, I'm just throwing it out there. And I look towards others, and they're not so sure. And they're doing some things that, you know, and then what happens is when you're not so sure, and I'm not saying doubt is part of, I think doubt can be a part of your journey. But sometimes, to be holy, is you have to realize what you're being influenced by. And there's nothing really new under the sun, except Satan wants you to walk. It starts in a drift of baby steps. Just like it starts in the mind. And then everything starts in the mind in the Message translation, and James says, and then what starts in the mind gives birth or gets pregnant and then gives birth to sin. It starts in the mind. Baby steps, little drifts. The drifts are subtle. Last week, on Hutchinson Island, Florida, it is about 10 miles north of where I'm going, and my hotel rates are really cheap. They're like $300 a night, so I don't want to come. And if I know you, I'll give you $295. But in Hutchinson Island, it made news on national TV. This family of six, two of the children and the husband and wife, were in the water at the state park in Fort Pierce, and they got caught in a riptide. And that's where a current, and this current can pull you, and you don't really notice it at first, and then usually you panic and it starts pulling you, and it sweeps you out to the ocean. And you're not always aware at first, and tragedy happened. The parents died. But I don't think they were really aware of the current at first. People, listen to Jenny Allen. Does anyone know who Jenny Allen is? Am I the only one? Leah, raise your hand so I'm not using anyone's phone here. Jenny Allen's a really good speaker, and she's written a lot of books. She's from the IF conference. Listen to what Jenny Allen says. You know, I'm reading this not as an us and they Christians, like those drifters are not. I'm reading this as I reflect rich stuff, okay? Listen to what she says. This lady's brilliant. I'm actually gonna start reading her more again. People do not drift towards holiness apart from grace-driven effort. People, you and I, do not gravitate toward godliness and prayer and obedience to scripture and faith. We drift. There's a sinful nature. We drift towards compromise, and we call it tolerance. We drift towards disobedience. We call it freedom. We slouch towards prayerlessness, and we delude ourselves into thinking we have escaped legalism. Oh, that's good. We slouch, and we go prayerless and convince ourselves we've been liberated. It's a drift. It's the baby steps James is talking about. We look into the mirror earlier. See, all this flows for the book. We look into the mirror and we look, we see, and the reflection is of how we would be in the standards of God's, how we live out God, and we see something and then we walk away and don't do anything about it. It would be like going on an interview and actually one-on-one, not Zoom, and you have a pimple coming out of your head like this, and you see it, and you don't do anything about it. Well, that'd be insane. Right? Craziness. That's the beginning of the drift. As Philip Yancey writes in his book Disappointment with God, the drift sometimes starts in the disappointment with God. And I would say, and you don't have to agree with me, everyone in this room has been disappointed with God, if we are honest, about something. And sometimes that's the little space to get going. Sometimes that's the pressure of the culture to conform. And a lot of people, to take that step to conform, they won't say anything because they're afraid of getting canceled for the people that they've agreed with. So as I'm reading all this, 19 to 20, it's just two verses, right? It's not a lot. You probably thought you'd be out of here by now, but I'm going to keep you. I'm thinking, as I'm reading this, we got to be careful how we approach people. We can become arrogant, right? You know, we become like that guy I told you in college, Holy Joe. It was not a compliment at all. We can become church police, you know, and we knocking on doors with our flashlights, and I've been following you for 3 days, you know, that's craziness, right? But when someone's drifting, we have to take some time to reflect and look at our life first. Because I know, and you don't have to agree with this either, I hate that us and they mentality. I get it. I'm talking, I even don't like the us and they mentality within the church. Because I got to reflect on myself before I go in with a flashlight. I'm not saying we don't do these things. Don't hear that. You got to have a posture of humility when you come into those situations. Because I know sometimes I don't live the Christian life out. Anyone else? Dan, can you leave? No, I'm kidding. How about some of these? Let's not take the real serious stuff or that word. Sometimes I don't display grace. Sometimes I don't care about my neighbor. I'll tell you a story. There's a man that walks down the street here all the time, and he limps, you know what I'm talking about? He's Spanish, and he doesn't speak English. And I've taken him home over the years to his place, and I gotta admit to you, I'm being really honest with you, you can fire me. I saw him the other day and I hid from him. No, I admit it. I pretend I was reading the mail from the church. I didn't want to take him home. How hard would it have been to take him home? Sometimes I don't want to be love my neighbor as myself. Now, if I see him this week, I would do it because I got to make myself feel better. But I want to be honest before God. How about this? I got to reflect on myself. These are things that are all through the New Testament. Am I generous towards the poor? Am I forgiving? How do I see the poor? What flies through my mind that I won't tell anyone about? It's all called just that we need Jesus, right? All those things as reflection is I need God. So we're not perfect. We fall. We get back up. It's all through the book of James. But we have the ability to get back up because of God's Holy Spirit. We have the ability to live the holiness life because of God's Holy Spirit. So James, I'm actually 19 now. Brothers and sisters, he's talking to the church, he's talking to people who put their faith in Jesus Christ. He says this, if a fellow brother in Christ wanders off, drifts away from the faith, goes back to maybe some of their old sinful ways. Remember in the book of 1 Corinthians, I'm not sure where, it says, you used to do this, but now you found Christ, so now you don't do that. And that's a really rough paraphrase.
You're a new creation.
So what he's saying here is what James is trying to communicate is there will be times when the Lord will want you to approach someone. Not with your badge, but with a heart of humility. And maybe not as much as you think that you have to approach them. Just throwing it out there because there's other people that are doing it and you don't even know. But it's a church thing. Now, I had a friend that was not living out his faith. And I talked to him finally one night. I said, what the heck are you doing, man? I didn't shame him. I didn't scold him. I said, some of the things you're doing, I guess I think about, but I'm not doing them. But what are you doing? And, it's like that John 8:1, I don't condemn you, but he told the woman, but go and sin no more. I said, you can't, that is not what God wants you to do, dude. And he said, I know he kept doing it. A long time, but he's changed his ways, and he actually calls me about once a year. What happens when life throws you curveballs? What happens when the sin nature roars? When the disappointments come, and you thought, "Hey God, I had to deal with you. I thought it'd be different." I think what James is saying, it's the opening to a drift. We all drift in some capacity. It's the beginning of a drift to begin to wander. Let me give you an example. I know nothing about cars. So when the engine light goes on, I just open the hood and stare at it, like miraculously God's going to fix it, or I don't know what to do, I just call AAA. In fact, the other day in Meadwood Park, I went for this long walk, and I was dripping sweat, I was going home to shower, and the car didn't start. So I just put the hood up, and I stood there. What do you do? Well, that's another story. So if you ever, engine light ever go on?
Yep.
And you keep driving? I don't even look at it anymore. I cover it with paper. And you keep driving. Well, that engine light's on for a reason. Now, I know that the engine light sometimes goes on. It happened in one of my kids' cars recently, and the car was fine. But sometimes when the engine light's on, it's trying to tell you something.
Warning.
Yeah. It's a warning. Hey, maybe I should take a look at this. The Holy Spirit kind of knocks on your chest. He's trying to get your attention. Let me just say this, and this is, I'm just going to say it. The greatest cause of atheism today is Christians to say one thing and do another. People are, you know that old saying in the Bible, and someone reads, validity in that, right? I mean, but we drift sometimes, and that's what James is saying. To the drifters, yes, but I think he's saying it to, hey, be careful. Be careful how you approach this. Today in culture, we see elements of a drift of the church. Now, the church can do different things, and maybe they need that, they're always looking at things, but the message is always the same. But there's a drift. There's a what we call a deconstruction of faith. And I've talked about this. I studied it on my own. Process theology is where when people begin to drift, or I'm not sure about what I once believed, or all these kind of stuff. And people go through those things, you know? And it is sometimes now when people begin to, there's a whole movement of we don't even care what the Bible says. But before we would hang our hat on Scripture, but now we don't care. But we still will claim some Jesus. So how do you claim Jesus but not the Word? But there's a drift. Some of the drift is, well, cavemen, archaic individuals wrote the Bible. They were, how would they know anything? That's published. People follow. One's feelings are more important than what God says. Follow your heart. Sacrifice of salvation is archaic. I've heard that in churches on YouTube. So salvation is no longer what Christ did. Salvation is your cause. Salvation is Jesus that flips your heart for a cause. See, it all goes back to works theology. Hermeneutical gymnastics. All that means is, when you study the Bible, with you know, look at grammar, language, context, history, and you bring it all together, and people can agree to disagree on a lot of stuff, even in evangelical Christianity, okay? But they do hermeneutical gymnastics. If you look at fruit, what does fruit of the Bible mean? If you obey God, you show fruit, right? Generically, I know a writer that is very popular, says, no, that's bad fruit. Because they're trying to force what they want it to say. So it's hermeneutical gymnastics. Like, what? So the reality is, the people that are going to go to someone who's wandering, you and I stray at times. As the simplicity of something gets stuck in your mind and you don't want it out, you're driving somewhere. When you see a dog roaming aimlessly through your neighborhood, what do you call it? A stray. It's a dog, it's a stray. It's roaming around from its home. It's strayed. And if the dog has a chip in it or a little collar with the title, with the address, you might call the master and say, hey, your dog's in the wrong neighborhood, in essence. Can you come get it? I found it. So you return it to its master, where it belongs. The word wandered in Greek, okay, I got a solid B in Greek, so I'm going to pretend I know what's wrong. Planeo in English means to roam from safety, to roam from truth. You can't make this stuff up, right? God's word is truth. It's not relative, it's God's word, it's absolute. When Mallory and Erin were real little girls, we would take them to Barnes & Noble. And at the back of the Barnes & Noble, they had this children's reading section, and they had these big, like, cool Winnie the Pooh things. And it was all decorated on the stage. Winnie the Pooh and Eeyore, and my kids would love it. They'd have story hour. I remember I was by myself once, and I took them there, and I coughed, or took a sip of coffee, and I couldn't find them. That was scary. They were gone for like 45 seconds. You know what happened when that happened? And I couldn't find them? Rescue mode, because I wanted them back. Years ago, there's a show, it's actually still on, it's called The Deadliest Catch.
Oh yeah.
And in The Deadliest Catch, it's a show where these crab fishermen in the Bering Sea, and people fall off the boats and die, and the waves take the boats down sometimes, and they call, mayday, 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 and these helicopter guys from the Coast Guard will fly through this crazy weather, and then these crazy men and women, they actually jump into the water from that helicopter. I'm like, what are you doing, man? That's crazy. And they'll help people in this little basket, and they'll rescue them. I think that's what James is saying. When you see the wander, when you see the drift, reflect on yourself, have a posture of humility. But there are people that God calls you to talk to. We don't change anybody. We don't save anybody. God's power saves. God changes people. If you think you've changed someone or saved someone, can you talk to me afterwards? You didn't save anybody. Only God saves. God uses you as a vehicle, but you don't save anybody. May we reflect on our lives. You know that expression, have a come to Jesus moment? Hey Jesus, what am I about here that's uncool in your eyes? God's power does change us. We're the vehicle. Now I'm not going into Calvinistic theology at all. I'm probably a two-pointer with a gun in my head. But I think once saved, always saved is legit. That's God's deal. God knows the heart. God knows and there's scriptures that say if you're not, I get it. And you can argue it to the cows come home, whatever that means. Forever. And it's not the grace card and intellectual salvation. God knows. But notice that James says, wandering believers. Believers who stray. So here's the thing. We pray. You know, there's people, grandmothers and grandfathers and parents that pray for their kids for 30, 40 years. 30 and long. Never give up. The prodigal son repented in the middle of his tracks. Did a U-turn and came back to the ways of God. To restore one is to their former condition, meaning in Christ they kind of pushed all that out. It's like if you found a Pepsi machine from 1940 and you took it to get restored, you know, that kind of thing. So here's the deal. Pray for the church. Pray for this church. Pray for the people in this church. Pray for people. Approach them in a posture of humility. Listen to them. It says it earlier on in James, be quick to listen. Point them to Jesus. Someone comes back, and that the term of multiple sins is just God forgives when we come to repentance. So this morning, as we participate in communion, So this morning, as we sing the song first, and then into communion, as you sing the song, reflect on your very own life as we live out faith. Jesus Christ.
They don't need a communion cup.
night before Jesus went to the cross, he took the bread and he said to his disciples, "This bread represents my body that we've been broken for you." And every time we take the bread, remember what Christ did for us. And he says, when you take it, remember this until I come again. Take and remember. On the same night, Jesus took the cup and he said, "This cup is the new covenant. Without the shedding of blood, there's no forgiveness of sins. I am the once and for all final sacrifice by grace." Every time we take the cup, we're reminded it is by the blood of Jesus Christ that saves. He did it for you. Remember and take until he comes again. Amen. Thank you.